It's that time of the week when former football and sports stars share their stories. It happens all right here, right now, on Thursday Night Tailgate. With your hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. Guys, have some fun. Enjoy the guests. Take it away.
Hey, thank you, Joe. Good evening, everybody, and thank you for coming back and joining us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate, your home of the NFL Alumni Association and the Gridiron Greats. TNT is brought to you by the great folks over at Kyven Foods, Coastal Orthopedics, the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory, and the French Lick Resort. I'm your host, Chris Mascaro, and tonight my co-host Bob Lazzari and I are back, and we have five great guests that we are looking forward to sharing with you tonight. Show's going to have a bit of a South Beach or a Miami feel to it tonight because we have three former Dolphins joining us. Our first guest is going to be a good friend and former Colts and Dolphins fullback Don Nottingham. We've always had a great time when Don's been a part of the show. We'll get his thoughts on the Dolphins for this coming season. And if you think running backs have been devalued, take a look at the fullbacks. We'll see what Don thinks of fullbacks and what their position or part of the game, you know, they'll have a few years from now. Plus a whole lot more when he is here with us about 15 minutes from now. Then former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins. You know, Tony's a regular part of the show every single week at 8:30 p.m. Eastern time. So, and Tony, as well, as I'm sure you guys are aware, is a motivational speaker now and a very positive person, which is why Bob and I enjoy him so much. But with everything that's going on in the country right now, you know, Tony recently posted on his Facebook page that we need to stop hating and start loving. And he is absolutely right about that. So the question is, you know, how do we start a movement like that? You know, Bob and I have been trying to do that, you know, a little bit here on the show with our spotlight on the positive every single week, but we'll get Tony's thoughts as well. He'll be along with us at the bottom of the hour. Following Tony, we'll get a much overdue return visit from former Falcons wide receiver Brian Finneran. We'll talk to Brian and get his insights on what he expects from the Atlanta Falcons this season. You know, Brian also does color analysis for his alma mater, Villanova. So, you know, he did. He was on the mic for the national championship game as, you know, they won over North Carolina. So Brian was right there just a few feet away from Chris Jenkins when his buzzer beater was launched and obviously goes through the hoop. And Brian was, like I say, just a couple of feet away from that. So what was that like? You know, your alma mater being on the mic and watching a national championship happen right in front of you. We'll find out when Brian joins us a little bit later in this hour. We'll kick off hour number two with former Dolphins linebacker and current vice president of wellness and clinical services for the NFL, Dwight Hollier, will be back with us. So we'll talk to Dwight on, you know, we'll get his thoughts, obviously, on the Dolphins. We'll talk a little bit about his alma mater, the University of North Carolina. So as Brian Finneran was on the, feeling great, right? Watching Villanova win the national championship. Dwight's on the other end on the agony of defeat on that one for North Carolina. So we'll talk a little bit about that. Plus, we'll talk about his transition from being a player and now getting into the NFL front offices. So, like I say, being the vice president of wellness, I'm sure there's a lot of programs that he'll want to talk about that they are doing to take care of the current and former players. So we'll find out about that about an hour from now. And then we're going to round out the show with the third of our three Dolphins, former offensive lineman and TNT Hall of Famer, John Bock, going to be back with us. And you know, John has been a regular guest on the show for the last couple of years, not quite as much this year as he has been in years past. So we need to fix that. But John is also one of the brightest coaching minds that we've ever had on the show. So we'll talk about his training camp memories, if he thinks Ryan Tannehill is a franchise quarterback, and if he were a head coach or an offensive coordinator in the league, how frequently would he go for two? We've heard Mike Steelers talk about, you know, going for it the majority of the time this upcoming season. Is that a good idea? We'll see what John thinks. He'll be here about 90 minutes from now. So a lot of good friends joining us again tonight. We're going to have a lot of fun. So sit back, relax, and let us take your mind off all of the other things going on in your life for the next couple of hours. But let's get things started by bringing in my co-host, Mr. Bob Lazzari. Bob, how are you tonight, my friend?
Good evening. How are you, Chris?
I'm really well. Thank you, sir. You know, we were talking a little bit, you know, off the mic. You know, it's always a curious time of year. Yeah, you know, as the summer heats up, right? As summer heats up, So do the thunderstorms and severe weather and all of that sort of thing. You guys up in New England, you always got seem to get things from a weather perspective, whether it's always in one extreme to the other. Really cold and snowy, really hot and rainy. You guys don't do a whole lot from a weather perspective in moderation, my friend.
Not at all, Chris, as has been advertised on this show many times, but it's been cooking all week. It started very pleasant, a little warmer the next day, a little warmer with humidity the next day, really warm with real humidity today, and then, of course, the thunder stuff started around 5 o'clock. Right. But, same here, Chris, drought-type weather, and then all of a sudden you get a deluge, but it's not enough, and then people are complaining about their wells running dry, and you can't win. You hear me complaining in the winter, and now the summer presents whole different problems, although I'll take the heat over the winter any day. But, again, you could live in New England, as most people say. You could live anywhere.
Yeah, there you go. And, Bob, before we get any further into the show, I want to start things off by, picking your brain a little bit and want to get your thoughts on a story that, unfortunately just, will not die. It's the story in the NFL that just won't go away, and that's the Blakegate, right? This week, the second U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals denied the NFLPA's and Tom Brady's appeal of his four-game suspension. The court issued a very elegant one-sentence response to their appeal request. It is hereby ordered that the petition has been denied. So it's hereby ordered that petition denied. Period. No, nothing else. Nothing else in the response back to them, which I really think, Bob, is sort of court speak for no. Now quit bothering us, right? So, Bob, I guess the question becomes: is it finally time for Brady to really accept his four-game suspension and let's move on?
Oh, absolutely, but he probably will not. But don't you get that feeling, Chris, that the court had had enough of Deflategate? And trust me, here in New England, people were on the bandwagon, free Brady T-shirt. They're even getting sick of it up here, Chris. It's almost as if we can't read about it anymore. We don't want to hear it about it anymore. But now he's gone so far as if he stops now, it'll almost be like embarrassed that he went this far. So kind of dug his own hole, Chris. I mean, look, if you're a very talented team, I know four games, Chris, is a quarter of a season. You could look at it that way. It sounds like a lot. But a talented team with the best coach in football, you figure if you have confidence in your other guys and Garoppolo has some experience, et cetera, you figure you got a very good shot of winning probably three of those games. So this should have been over a long time ago, Chris. From what I'm hearing, he can actually, if Ginsburg, who is going to probably be the one that hears this, if Ginsburg puts a stay on this thing, then he'll probably be able to play, and he could actually not even have to start the process until October, and he could get an extension past October to have the hearing even pushed farther before the Supreme Court can decide, oh, no, we're not going to look. But guess what? He wouldn't have missed any games and everything. And then everybody's talking about the flip side of it. You have to show cause that it's cost him harm. How a guy with a wife that beautiful and all that money and all the Hall of Fame potential has been caused harm is beyond me. And, Chris, trust me, I follow the Patriots. I love Brady. You can't help but respect the franchise. But, look, the guy cheated. He got caught. He's got money. And you play for the, quote-unquote, villain team of the NFL, so you kind of do what people don't want you to do. So, again, all of us here want it to go away. Will it, Chris? I don't think so. I think you're going to see very shortly. He's got to do it pretty quick to say, I want to take this to the next step. But you would just think, out of an embarrassment standpoint, if you've come this far, then it would look like he had egg on his face if he just gave up. But the right thing to do would say, look, take my four games, help Garoppolo get ready, and let's win three out of these four games.
Yeah, I mean, and that's a great point, Bob. You know, I mean, at the end of the day, right? I mean, the Patriots, you know, the Patriots will figure out a way, right? I mean, Matt Castle went 11-5 when they didn't have Brady for the whole year. You know, you would think, you know, in my worst case scenario, that they come out of this thing 2-2, right? And if you know, at that point, you know, after only four games, you know, you have, you know, you're going to probably win 12 of the next, you got 12 games left, right? You're probably going to win 10 of them, right? So you go into 12-4. That's going to get you a 1 or 2 seed in the AFC. Let's just be done with this thing. I mean, but, you know, I unfortunately, Bob, I agree with you. I think what's going to happen is he's going to drag it out and put stays and all that sort of stuff, hoping to push it far enough out that it gets through the season. And, you know, maybe he looks at next year sitting out or whatever, if it doesn't happen. Because you know the Supreme Court's not hearing this thing. If the second, you know, Circuit Court of Appeals isn't going to hear this thing, there's no way the Supreme Court is going to hear this thing. Right? It's ridiculous to think that they would.
You got better things to do, no?
Yeah, exactly right. So, I mean, the question just becomes, right, you know, I mean, do you want to miss the beginning of this year or do you want to miss the beginning of next year? Let's just get over with it and move on. Unless, you know, and we obviously don't know what goes on behind the scenes. Are they still trying to negotiate perhaps with Roger Goodell? You know, what I would really love to see, Bob, is Goodell come out at this point and go, look, you can push this stay until October, but I'm telling you, you're going to serve a 4-game suspension this season because the Supreme Court's going to deny this thing. So I'm going to make you sit out 4 games this year, right? And that's what, you know, part of, you know, the debrief was, is that, you know, Roger Goodell was within his rights based on the, you know, based on the agreement between the, you know, between the league and the NFLPA and the collective bargaining piece, that he was within his rights to do what he did, right? So if he comes out and says, you're sitting 4 games, Tom, we can wait 10 weeks into the season and then you can make your 4 games, right? Is that really what you want to do for your team, right, as you are preparing for a playoff run potentially, right, to miss games at the end of the year versus the beginning of the year? Hey, you want to wait it out? You can wait it out, but you're getting 4 games this year. I promise you that.
Yeah, there's and that's what you described is just, you know, all ego. If they
right.
continue to fight it, I mean, stop already. I mean, it's just so out there now, Chris. I mean, to have spent millions on both sides, really, to have spent millions. And, you know, again, whatever side you take, again, even people in New England, I mean, they're saying today, if Hillary Clinton can run for president and Tom Brady can't play football, I mean, that's the last one of my buddies tweeted that out, but
right.
Keep away from politics. But, yeah, again, take the 4 games, get Garoppolo ready, and then come in and see how again, Chris, they're still favored to win the Super Bowl with him missing 4 games.
Right.
So what am I missing? I don't know. Just, you know, do the right thing. Ego,
exactly.
It's all ego right now.
Bob, updates on the guests you've got scheduled and you've had recently on your show Monday Night Sports Talk
with
our friend Tony D'Angelo?
Yeah, what a show the other night. We had a major, major Yankee fan who was an author who wrote a book, Boycott the Yankees, believe it or not. He's just fed up with you talking about capitalism. And I've told you on the other shows and both personally how corporate it is at Yankee Stadium now and how they've really priced out people. Mike DeLucia is his name. Boycott the Yankees. Check it out, man. He has some incredible ideas. He's fed up. He's a huge, huge baseball and Yankee fan and continues to be. But he's saying to myself, a $2 billion franchise, there is enough money to go around for everybody and still keep it affordable for fans. We're the suckers. We're getting scammed, and he's had enough. And it was something. It really was eye-opening, even though we talk about it all the time. This coming from a Yankee fan and a very educated man, he teaches school, was very eye-opening.
Very good. It's again, you can find it online, mondaynightsports.net. You can check it out there. Plus, you can also find them on their YouTube channel, Monday Night Sports. Check out all the great interviews that Bob and Tony have done over the years. They really are fantastic.
Thanks.
All right, everyone, like we do here every week on Thursday Night Tailgate, we want to send out a big hello and an even bigger thank you to our military personnel who are listening in around the world on the Armed Forces Radio Network. We can't say thank you enough for doing what you do to protect all of our freedoms and our liberties and our way of life. For everyone else listening in, thank you for doing so. We hope you'll join us in thanking our brave men and women serving in every branch of our military. If you happen to see a member of our military out and about, whether in a restaurant, just anywhere in your daily life, please stop for a moment and tell them thank you. They are our real heroes. We also want to thank our veterans for your service and the sacrifices that you and your families have made for us over the years. Big thank you as well to Sean Cruz and the wonderful folks over at the Armed Forces Radio Network. It is such an honor for us to have Thursday Night Tailgate as a part of your network. You can find our show by going to armedforcesradionetwork.org. And veterans, please continue to check out globalvoiceforveterans.org. You hear us talking about it every week here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Great site with news and articles that you're going to find both beneficial and interesting to you. It is specifically geared towards our veterans out there. globalvoiceforveterans.org. TNT is brought to you by the great folks over at Kyven Foods. It's owned and operated by our good friend and former Bengals and Falcons tight end and TNT Hall of Famer Reggie Kelly. If you want to be king of the grill this summer, folks, it is a must that you use Kyven Sweet Barbecue Sauce, ranked number 15 in the world right now by Barbecue Superstars. This barbecue sauce is a must for the big games, your tailgating needs. It is available at select Walmarts and Kroger's throughout the eastern half of our country for locations and online orders, recipes as well. Check out their site, kyven82.com. And Kyven is spelled K-Y-V-A-N. And if your local Walmart doesn't carry the Kyven Sweet Barbecue Sauce, well, request it. I'm sure they'll be happy to add it to their shelves for you. TNT is also sponsored by Dr. Peter Candelora and the great folks over at Coastal Orthopedics. Folks, if you're dealing with joint pain, whether it's in your shoulders, in your elbows, in your hips, your knees, your feet, please stop and do what the gridiron greats do to get relief. Contact Coastal Orthopedics. They can get you back to enjoying life. For more information, check them out online at bone-dr.com. Like Bob's mentioning baseball, we're at the halfway point now, right? And if you love the game and you're looking for a great place to take your family this summer, well, you're going to love the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory. It is such a cool experience for everyone in the family because you get to walk their live production line and see the bats being manufactured right there in front of you. There are a lot of cool exhibits as well. You can still see the Ripley's Believe It or Not exhibit that's got some kind of bizarre baseball treasures. They recently added a life-size statue of Jackie Robinson, which is amazing. Plus, you hear me bragging about this every single week, folks, because I was actually in there. You got to check out the Balt Bat that actually holds game-used bats from some of the game's greatest legends. To find out more information about the museum and to book your visit, go to sluggermuseum.com. Please also check out our newer friends, the French Lick Resort. You want to talk about a fantastic place to stay and play golf. If you love golf, you got to check this place out. But even if you just like, you know, simply relaxing and enjoying life, it's a great place as well. What a fantastic setting. You got two championship golf courses, one designed by Pete Dye, the other by Donald Ross. The Pete Dye course was the host of last year's Senior PGA Championship and the LPGA Legends Championship. Donald Ross designed course was the site of Walter Hagen's PGA Championship victory back in 1924. Got a great spa right there on site and a casino, my friends, as well. To find out more information about that and to book your stay, go to FrenchLick.com. We've got our first guest hanging on the line. We are going to get to Don Nottingham on the other side of this station identification.
Hey, guys, this is Dr. Jen Welter of the Texas Revolution and Team USA, and you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with my good friends, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari on the Armed Forces Radio Network.
And now back with us and making his fifth appearance on Kyven Foods guest line is Don Nottingham. Let me quickly remind you about Don's career. He played his college ball at Kent State, where he was a three-year letterman, and he captained the team his senior season. And he was named All-Mid-American Conference in 1969 and 1970. Don was a 17th-round draft pick by the Baltimore Colts in 1971, and he played in the NFL from 71 to 78 for the Colts and the Dolphins. He was traded from the Colts to the Dolphins midway through the 1973 season and became a part of the Dolphins' Super Bowl VIII championship team. Over the course of Don's career, he had 611 carries for nearly 2,500 yards, and he scored 34 touchdowns, added 67 receptions, and another 502 receiving yards. And from 1974 to 1976, he was among the top 10 running backs in touchdowns. He's become a wonderful friend of the show, and we're very excited that he is back with us again tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Don, Chris, and Bob, thanks for coming back on the show.
Hey, Don.
Thanks for having me, Chris and Bob. I appreciate it. It's always good to talk to you guys.
Thank you.
So, Don, we're a couple of weeks away from training camp opening up. You know, what teams are allowed to do today in camp has got to be much different than what you went through when you were back in training camp. What do you remember about being in camp with the Colts and the Dolphins from the 70s?
I can basically remember the tremendous mental gap that I had to jump from going from college to the pros. We not only had to know what the play was, but you had to know what the play could morph into depending on what the defensive guys did. And you had to do it all on the run. And that was the hardest thing for me because I was, I mean, it's no secret, I was a straight-ahead guy. And all of a sudden, if the end would do a ram charge and my guard's not going to take the end on, I've got to know to take a step wider and go around him. Otherwise, I'm not going to be in position to do what I got, and I'm not going to make the team. That was the most difficult thing for me. And what I see now with the way the setup is now with how few pure contact practices they're allowed, I don't believe I could have made the NFL in today's time frame. At least when I played, we had like almost total 6 solid weeks of 2-a-day hard hitting, at least 10 or 15 plays a day that were live. And so you had a chance to show what you could do. Making it into the NFL today is much, much harder than when I played.
Yeah, and that's a great point, Don. You know, a guy like you, that obviously 17th round draft pick, we don't have it. You know, the draft isn't that deep anymore. But whether it's guys that are coming in the the 6th round, 7th round, or undrafted free agents, you really have less of an opportunity now to show that you belong than you did back then. Whether it's from the draft perspective, or even they have so much, there's so fewer practices where you're allowed to hit, right? You make a really good point.
Exactly.
Yep,
and the way I unless I understand it totally wrong, they're not allowed to be actually in pads every single day. And like I said, the only way I made it was by basically hitting everybody who came near me hard enough to make everybody understood that it costs you if you run into Nottingham. And that's That was my strategy, because I was told by everybody, you're going to get a cup of coffee and you're going to get sent home. what do you do if you? That's what I tell kids when I talk to them. You don't ever let anybody tell you what you can do. You go show them what you can do, and if it isn't good enough, then you go home with your head up. But you go home doing it the right way. You don't cry about it. You just gave it my best shot, and I got sent home. Okay. But now I'm just saying, I at least had so many more opportunities. I also got lucky. Most of my summer camp with the Baltimore Colts, when I started, I practiced with Johnny Unitas in the huddle with me. You know what that's like, having a guy like that call the plays and look you in the eye and call your number? You just knew it was going to work. I mean, yeah, I had so much more of a mental edge than anybody else could have had as a rookie. Just having him in the huddle, I can't explain to people correctly how much I think that he meant to me as far as trusting in us and teaching us how to play the game, and then not ever apologizing. Do your best shot and keep coming.
So, Don, do you still go down? Do you go down to Fort Lauderdale at all to training camp and watch, what's going on and what it's like and share your stories?
I don't go down to the camps much, but I kind of keep myself busy here in Marion County. I help out with Special Olympics. We have a tremendous program. We have so many good I call them kids. The politically correct thing is to call them athletes. But they're kids to me, and I can't help it. I love what they do. I love their attitudes, and that's why I'm happy to go out. And so I tell them, I beg for money every day for people to give me some of their money so we can make these kids have a good time and let them find out what it's like to compete. So I don't drive as much as I used to. I'm getting old, I'm not a young chicken anymore.
Bob, questions for Don?
It's great to speak with you again, Don. And I just wanted to ask you, since we're talking in July and training camps are coming up quickly and it's incredibly hot and humid here in New England, back in the day, Don, as far as hydration, you are a guy that worked so hard, and these training camps, you're talking about two-a-days, and they were not easy. And I remember playing high school football in the late 70s, and all we had, this is before the advent of your Gatorade and things like that. I remember taking salt pills and everything. How did you cope with it, Don, and did you ever have any trouble with being dehydrated this time of the year?
I was always pretty lucky. I listened to what the trainers said. Trainers were always very clear about making sure that we, you have to take salt tablets. There's no way around it. There's no way you can shortcut it. You can't drink enough liquid to get the electrolytes back up. And I mean, now the Gatorade came out and all that stuff, but it was basically salt tablets and making sure you just drank a lot of, just an awful lot of water. To this day, I still drink a lot of water. I just, I was told that if you don't drink water, you're gonna come and see the prostate doctor quicker. So I've always stayed with that. And but we never really had water on the practice field until about 1976, I think, or 77, I think it was. You know, we had a whole series of really bad knee injuries with the Dolphins, and that's funny because the next year after that, we had water. And from then on, now we had water, you could go get it. You were kind of considered a wimp if you had to have the water, could make it through an hour and a half practice. But being fair, the last practice, Dolphin practice I went to, it was like a three-hour practice. I couldn't believe it. They were standing around like they were. We were on the field, but we were moving. We did 15 minutes of this, 20 minutes of that, another 30 minutes of this, and then we do the stuff where we break into groups at the end and just work on individual stuff. But it was fast move and get it off, and then you had a chance to get rested up and get ready to go watch the film in the afternoon.
And, Don, that first year of 71, I mean, here you are. You're playing behind Norm Boulash, Tom Matte. Did anyone in training camp at any time approach you and said, I mean, you ended up getting 95 carries, probably had a decent load, and yet 5 touchdowns. Did anybody approach you and said, this is going to be your role for this year, you're going to be within this many carries or whatever? Or did this just kind of materialize that you were able to get the carries that you did?
Well, I think the system in Baltimore when I got there was basically Don Shula's system. You know, Don McCafferty was Shula's coordinator and took over when Shula went to Miami. So basically it was the Miami Dolphin setup. And that way you're always were taught, you have to keep your name, keep your mind on what the game's about, always be ready to if you're called on to step in. My big luck, I think I got to play a lot my rookie year because Norm Boulash was a fantastic back, and he was like one of these hybrid, really top-of-the-line thoroughbred horses, man. He was always popping hamstrings, and I never pulled a muscle in my life. But, I mean, he was just so good, and he made so many crazy moves that he was always getting gimpy. So as soon as we'd get ahead in the game, they'd pull him out, and I got some playing time when most of the time rookies didn't get that. So it was just kind of a lucky thing that I was in the right place because they pull Boo out of the game because it's a long, 14 games back in. That's a long season. Now it's 16. Different ball game, all different ball games. All I did was I stayed close to the coach. If they had a chance to put me in, he's not going to have to look for me.
And Don, like I mentioned in your intro, you were a part of the Dolphins Super Bowl VIII championship team. When you look back at, you know, at the Super Bowl event that you were a part of, and now you see what the Super Bowl is like nowadays, how do the two compare?
I don't believe there is a comparison. It's funny. We just moved into a smaller house, and I'm finding stuff in boxes. And one of the things I found was a block of, plastic. It's got a Super Bowl ticket from that Super Bowl in it. You know what the price was on it?
What's
15
that?
Bucks.
Oh, wow.
That should tell you everything you need to know. I mean, $15 for a Super Bowl ticket. I mean, holy cow! I don't know how a family can go to a football game anymore. But it's
yes.
Things have certainly changed, and you know, I got the benefit of the World Football League when Zonka and Kick and Warfield went up and made that deal with the guy in Canada and then signed with the WFL. That immediately got me up from I got a big raise and I didn't do anything for it.
That's curious, you know, that you mentioned that, Don, because, you know, they left right shortly after the Super Bowl, really, is when they signed that deal. You know, obviously that gave you more of an opportunity and some other players more of an opportunity, perhaps, to, you know, for playing time. But what was it like for the team when they told you that, you know, hey, we're leaving here, we're going to go do this thing? Did you guys look at it as it's a business decision for them? Fine, do it. Or was there a team letdown that they would leave?
I think absolutely everybody was happy for him because, I mean, you always want your buddies and your teammates to do as good as they can do. And then they, like Zonka told me, he says, you know, this sets my family up for life. And how could you ever say anything negative about that? Bottom line is, all of us owe our family first call. I'm positive. I am absolutely positive that Zonka never did not want to not be a Dolphin. But it's, you know, it's business. And it is a business. No question about it.
Bob, one more for Don before we let him go.
Hey Don, it's always, it must be an honor to have played with Hall of Famers like you did. I'm just looking at the rosters of some of those teams. In Baltimore, you had Unitas, John Mackey, Ted Hendricks, guys that were borderline like a Mike Curtis. I mean, you mentioned Unitas and what it meant having him, but just being around Hall of Famers, it probably had a lot to do with your success later down the road in everything you did.
No question about it. And I'm a big believer in mentors. And it's funny because Earl Morrow was an old man my rookie year with the Colts, and he was there. He was the guy in the locker room. He was, you know, Earl's the only man that I've ever met in the NFL that I have never once heard anybody say anything negative about. He is just an impressive man and a great teammate, and never put anything ahead of the team. I mean, that was that was the kind of guys that you had. Tom Maddy, you know, he was 12 years in the league when I came up, but he even had to talk to people on how to get everybody prepared mentally. You know, basically, I don't think we had a lot of Cinderella type guys or you know, the big macho guys that had to be the top of the show. Everybody, I think, had a sense of their worth. But I think they were also pretty darn humble. I know that I was told early and often, when a kid comes up to you to ask for an autograph, you can not only give him an autograph, but Earl said, you get down on a knee and look him in the eye and give him the autograph.
Wow.
Let him know you're looking at him. And that kind of stuff, I don't know. I just don't see it as readily flowing today as it used to. But those were the old-time guys. That's what Earl would say. These guys are the ones that pay for the tickets. That's how we get paid. And that was what I thought was fantastic. And like I said, I played with a bunch of guys that were not Hall of Famers that were Hall of Famers to me because they were team players. I know when you're a kid from Ohio in Baltimore and you get an off night, I had no place to go. And at $65 a week per diem, I had not a lot of money to spend to go anywhere. And you get guys like Freddie Miller as an offensive or defensive tackle say, come on, Matt, you're coming home with me tonight. And everybody would take a rookie home with them and not leave us, have to just kind of be on our own. So that kind of family was pretty awesome. And it, I tell you what, it goes a long way when you think the chips are down, you can get that extra step. You can get that extra push that you need. And it's, it was always kind of came from the top down, right from Coach McCafferty. And when I got traded to Miami, the neat thing is I didn't have to learn anything new. All the terminology was the same. The difference was the offensive line was a little better. a lot better, matter of fact. But we had some guys that were pretty fantastic, and I thought great alignment in Baltimore. When I got to Miami, my head would just spin. I'm thinking, wow, this is pretty cool. I was a whole different kind of game. The emphasis was on running, which fit me. I mean, in today's game, I don't fit with what goes on today. Mm-hmm. So timing was all right. Everything was perfect for me because when I got to Baltimore, it was a time when they needed a backup fullback. And everything just kind of worked to my advantage.
And Don, you mentioned this a moment ago, but before we let you go, you do some wonderful work with the Marion County Special Olympics. Talk about what you're doing with them and any events you guys have coming up.
All right. Well, we just finished up a clay shoot in March. The first one we did, that did good. We had to move. We got kicked out of our office building because it got sold. So we had to come up with some cash. So I went down and talked to my guys in Miami at the NFL alumni group, the guys that I spend so much time with. And I got them to allow me to do a clay shoot in Marion County. And guys came up and shot. So we had a good day, and it's a different kind of people. So we had a clay shoot. Next thing we got coming up, I just finished a chicken cookout where we made chicken at the local Masonic Lodge, and people came by and picked it up where they could stay there and eat it, and then we ran a little quick Texas Hold'em game after that. Except I didn't give them. I tell them I don't give you money. I give you prizes. So the winning guy got an autographed football with about 35 NFL names on it. I said,
wow.
You can say what you want, but it's not what you're used to. They're used to getting bracelets and stuff when they play for that stuff, but bracelets cost me cash. I can take a football down, and these guys will sign it for me, and then I can give that to somebody, and it's something they can value forever. And next thing we got coming up in Marion County will be in October will be our golf tournament, and my third time we'll be doing a thing called Champions for Champions, where I bring in guys not just from football but from every sport, and we just have them kind of tell stories. And that gets really fun because if you've ever been around baseball and football and basketball, when you get them all in the same room, they all kind of start picking on each other. So it's kind of gets pretty interesting. So that's the kind of small thing we can do. And, you know, Marion County is kind of away from all the, you know, we're an hour and a half from Tampa and Orlando. And, you know, we're not next to anything big. There's not a lot of guys that live around here. So the guys come up, and I'm so appreciative for what they do, because they come up and give us our time, and we have a ball. And everything we try to do while we're raising money is there's nothing that says you can't laugh and have a great time while you're doing good things. That's what we kind of continue to try to do.
That's fantastic.
Thank you for letting me talk about that. I can talk about it forever, but ever since Earl and John Unitas took me to the state games in Maryland my rookie year, and we pinned medals and ribbons on these kids, and I still say kids, and I know I keep getting criticized because that's not politically correct, but I'm old, so just have to go with it. But my point is, when you put a medal on one of these guys, they light up like a Christmas tree. And then they just, it makes you, it warms my heart, and I can't get it out how much that means to watch that person have a chance to have their little moment in the sun. And that's so neat. And I think the Shrivers and whoever started the Special Olympics, they are fantastic people. And I've never even met them. I tell you what, though, we got a lot of bad things going on in our country and our community, but we also have a lot of good things. So I like to spend time worrying about the good things and trying to find ways to patch up the bad things if we could.
There you go. That's exactly right. So would we. Don, for our listeners that are intrigued, you may be in the area that you're at or not too far. You mentioned a couple of big cities because Marion County, correct me if I'm wrong, up around Ocala, Florida, is that right?
Marion County is in the center part of Florida, almost dead center and from the east, from the coast to the Atlantic Ocean to the Gulf, and we're probably closer to the Georgia line than we are to Cuba, but it's Florida looks like a big giant finger hanging out there. We're kind of in the middle of the thing, and Marion County is like one of the biggest counties in of the 67 in the state. But we're out in the middle of nowhere. We're kind of a, if you made a triangle between Tampa and Orlando and then did a long handle north about 80 miles, you'd have Ocala, and that's where Marion County is. Ocala is the center of Marion County.
Right.
So everybody drives by Ocala a lot.
Now, I was just going to say, for our listeners that are in and around that area, Don, and they want to keep up with, you know, what you might be doing or the next event that you're going to have, how can they find you guys online?
We have the Marion, the Special Olympics has a website, and you go to the basically Florida Special Olympics, and then there should be a page. It says Marion County, and that'll have a list of everything we've got going on, upcoming events, and the events that have already happened. A lot of good pictures, a lot of good information. I'm not good with all the WWW stuff, but the I have it. My daughter programmed it in my. I just push a button, it goes to it. So that's the easy way. Yeah. If you got a daughter, right, She'll find it for you. Marion County Special, Florida Special Olympics, and it'll be, I think it's / Marion County.
All right. Well, you know, Don, it's always such a great pleasure, and I thank you for what you know for sharing all of that and sharing all of your stories. We always love it when we get to spend some time with you. We hope you'll come back again soon and share more of your insights. Talk about the Dolphins and what they're doing this season and all of that. We love having you as part of the show.
I'm just hoping this new young coach down there can get them fired up. I think on paper we're as good as anybody, but we've got to prove it. Right now there's not much expected, so there shouldn't be any place to go but up. And like
right.
I said, don't tell me what I can do because I'm going to show you.
There you go.
Works.
Don, thanks again.
Have a great night, guys. Thank you.
You too. All the best to you and your
Always
family,
a pleasure.
My friend.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Former Colts and Dolphins fullback Don Nottingham. And I love that about the positive piece, Bob. Great stuff.
Yeah, he, again, you know, very involved, Special Olympics, and what a pleasure to speak with him, Chris. We get that old school feeling, you know, how he loved the old fullbacks, and my goodness, you know, the Baltimore Colts, that was probably one of the first teams I followed. Cut my teeth on them early 70s, and I remember him well in Unitas and Morrill and Mackey. It was just amazing, and you could tell he is so proud to have been associated with those guys. But can't wait for his sixth appearance, Chris. Great guy.
Yeah, absolutely right. All right, we've got our next guest hanging on the line now, back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line, and a little bit later than his weekly time slot is former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins. Tony, how have you been, my friend?
Tony, doing fantastic. How you guys doing?
Good. All right, thank you. So Tony, and you heard Don mention it sort of a moment ago, but I wanted to start our time tonight, sort of talking about, you know, this moment in time in our country. You know, to Don's point, we get hammered all day long about the bad news, you know, in the media. We're seeing a lot of senseless violence and shootings that make absolutely no sense in our country, you know, right now. You're a wonderful motivational speaker. That's one of the reasons why we love you so much. But there aren't a lot of, you know, happy times going on in our country right now. And you posted very recently on your Facebook page, we need to stop all the hating and do more loving, which you're absolutely right about, by the way. How do we do that?
Oh, wow, man. You know, right before I got on, I'm sitting here looking at TV and this crazy things happening over in France. You know, it's not our country, but you know they're people too, and you just sit and just think, man, what's going on with our world? You know, what's going on with people and how they're thinking? Because you know before they can do anything so tragically like what's been happening, they have to think about it. You know, you just don't do things without thinking about it. You have to think about it, and then you do it. And it's just amazing to me now where we are, especially here in our country. You know, we talk about the black and the white thing and the reason why, you know, the white police officers are killing the black young men. And I don't really believe it's a black and white thing. I just believe it's a thing where I know I've been stopped many times, not proud of it, been stopped many times by a police officer. And the worst thing that's ever happened to me is that I get a speeding ticket, you know. And the reason why, I believe, is that I was taught to respect authority. One of the things my mom and dad taught us was, you know, if you come against authority, it's like coming against God. So that was the type of fear that we were raised on. And I say fear, and when I say fear, I mean respect. That you never come against authority. Whenever there's an authority figure, like a teacher or a coach or a police officer, it's always yes, sir, and it's always no, sir. And I think one of the problems that we're having is our young men, black men, and not just black men, there's probably white men as well, our young black and white men are not taught to respect authority. And what's happening in many cases, when police officers stop these young black men, because they haven't learned to respect authority, they don't speak in a way that these police officers get respect. Now, I'm not saying that it's those black men's fault that they're getting shot. Of course, I think the police officers should have training and different things as well. But at the same time, these police officers are people. They're people too, just like everybody else. If you come up against someone that's talking to you in a certain way, and they're not respecting you, you don't know what's going to happen. You don't know what they're going to do. But if nine times out of ten, if a police officer stops someone and he's saying yes, sir, and no, sir, and gives that police officer respect that they actually deserve, I just can't see a good police officer doing anything bad to that person. Now, I could be wrong, but I just believe that's the thing that we're missing. You know, we're talking about Black Lives Matters and of course Black Lives Matter. Well, White Lives Matters too. Asian Lives Matters too. I mean, all lives matter. You know, you just can't say that just because what's going on in our country today. But at the same time, we have to raise our kids in a way to understand that they have to respect authority. You know, well, Chris, you know, I think about this thing, man, and it goes back. It goes all the way back to when they took prayer out of school. I growing up as a kid, you never, ever seen anything like a kid bringing a knife or a kid bringing a gun to school. None of this stuff ever happened when I was coming up. And once prayer got out of school, it seemed like, man, all hell broke loose. I think about stuff like I'm a big believer in God, and I think one of the biggest things that we're missing in our country today is that our young kids are not, they don't have the respect for God. They don't have respect for other people. They don't have respect for themselves. And this is getting really, really, really sad to see how our country is going and the way that we're going in. And I think we just need to get back to where we used to be, man, and the old-fashioned way and learning to respect others, learning to respect God, learning to respect authority. And I think that's one of the biggest things right now with this black and white thing. It's not a black and white thing. I really believe it's a God thing. It's a respect thing. And once our kids understand how to respect authority, how to respect other people's property, how to respect other people, and how to respect themselves, it's not going to change.
Well said. Bob, questions for Tony.
Now, I'm just sitting here with my mouth open, Tony, and those words are so incredibly well said. And having spent a long time working in education, mostly in a white community, Tony, it goes beyond the race with the respect and the way kids are brought up. And this must be very frustrating for you, Tony, because having talked to so many kids like you do, and you know at the basic heart of this is that families are so broken up these days that there may not be that authority figure, and it just becomes too much on one parent. A lot of us that had the two parents probably can't relate as well with this, but it's almost like kids rebel because they didn't have that guidance as a very young person. And I don't know if that's going to be changing in our lifetime, Tony.
You're absolutely right. And that's the sad part about it, where we have these men having babies and not their fathers, but they're not daddies. They're not taking responsibility of raising their kids. And it's tough, man. I can't even imagine coming up as a young kid and not having a father around. I can't even imagine that. So I just sit back and I wonder, you know, what these young men, coming from, broken homes, some coming from homes where there's no father around, and their mom is on drugs, and now they're raising themselves. So they have no chance of getting that teaching of respect. And can you blame them for that? You really can't, because they're in this loop where the only way that they can get any type of training is by going to school and trying to find a father figure at that school or maybe a coach or something like that. But the chances are they're not going to get that. So, you know, it's where us men, we have to step up and be responsible. It comes back again to being responsible and respecting, you know, what you're doing when you have a kid. When you have a kid, you got to be responsible for that kid. So, you know, it's tough, man. I mean, it's tough because you got so many kids, just like you said, that they don't get the training. If they don't know anything about respect, how can they even give respect, because they don't know nothing about it? So they're in a situation where they haven't been taught. So if you haven't been taught anything, you can't execute what you haven't been taught. So it's tough on those kids, man. It's tough in those neighborhoods. But at the same time, you know, you just hope and believe that these kids can catch on and understand that, you know, again, you still have to respect other people properly. You have to respect authority and respect yourself.
And being still doing the motivational speaking, Tony, do you get the feeling that your presence in these areas is more important now than it ever has been?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, that's one of the things that you know, I just spoke at this little Boys and Girls Club. They're out of school now, but, you know, I did those speaks, talk down here in North Carolina, and you know, talking to those kids at the Boys and Girls Club, and that's one of the things that we talked about. We talked about respecting others, respecting authority, and some of those kids, you know, they're looking at me like, what is he talking about? And I really had to sit down to explain to them. And then we got in a Q&A, and I understand some of them why they're, you know, looking at me like I was kind of crazy, because they have no idea about a father. They have no idea about respect and authority, and they don't understand that when you come against authority, you're actually coming against God, and that's one of the things that we talked about in that session. And, you know, hopefully some of those kids got it, and I think they did. And I think they understand how important coming against authority is and how to respect authority. Because one of the things that these kids want, they want respect. you know, that's what they really want. But in order to get respect, you got to give respect. And that's one of the biggest things now for our kids, and that what we're going to be preaching in my Right Choice program for this upcoming year. It's going to be about respect and about respect and authority. That's one of the things that we're implementing into our program right now, because I think that's a big issue. I mean, that's a huge issue. You know, we got these young black men dying simply because they don't know how to respect authority. And I truly believe that's what it's all about. It's not a black and white thing. It's a thing where these kids have not been taught how to respect authority. So if you're not taught how to respect authority, how can you execute respect and authority if you don't know nothing about it? And so that's our goal this year, is helping these kids understand how important it is to respect authority.
And Tony, before we let you go, on the positive side, remind our listeners about the great things that you're doing for kids, plus how they can follow you both online and on social media as well.
You can follow me at TonyCollinsFoundation.com and TonyCollinsProjects.com. We got two more golf tournaments left for this year. We're giving out scholarships to kids all over the country, man. It's a fun time right now for our foundation, because we're seeing these kids going off to college and helping these kids, and I'm having kids calling me and having parents calling me and thanking me for the little money that we give them. When I say it's little, you know, if you're giving out $1,500 scholarships, the college is expensive, man. And, you know, so that little $1,500 that we're giving is helping a lot. But we're hoping to get this thing as big as possible, so maybe next year we can give out a $2,500 scholarship. So everything is fantastic.
There you go.
We're hitting the pavement. We're helping kids. We're helping families. That's what life is all about.
Indeed it is. Tony, thank you so much for what you're doing and for continuing to be a part of the show. You know, it's always a blessing for us to have you here, and we thank you, and we look forward to catching up with you again next week, my friend.
Great stuff.
Absolutely.
Tonight.
You guys are fantastic, man. Keep up the great work.
Thanks, Tony. All the best to you and your family, my friend. We'll catch up again next week. That's former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins, and great stuff tonight, Bob.
Football took a backseat, Chris. I mean, and this is important stuff, and that was just some incredibly elevating stuff, the way he puts such an importance on what he's doing right now. And I have a tendency to believe everything and agree with everything he said, Chris. It comes down to a lot of respect and how kids are brought up, and it's black, white, it doesn't matter. I mean, again, I'm telling you, I deal with white kids all day long, and the disrespect level is off the charts bad. So, I mean, we'll talk, sure, I'm surely more about this with him as we go along, but Tony wants to get to the heart of the matter, and he's going to make it a point of his to just cherish and given and gain respect, and you have to get them early, Chris. I've always said that, and I always will believe that you got to get these kids early, and that's Tony's mission.
Yeah. And we've got our next guest, Brian Finneran, hanging on the line. We're going to get to Brian on the other side of this mission identification.
Hi, this is former Rams QB Jim Everett, and you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate, a.k.a. TNT. And it's explosive in here with my buddies, the hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. And we're listening to all this on the Armed Forces Radio Network. So take it away, Ben.
And now back with us and making his fourth appearance on the Kyven Foods guest line is Brian Finneran. Let me remind you about Brian's background. He played his college ball at Villanova, where during his senior season, he earned All-American honors and won the Walter Payton Award, given to the nation's top FCS Division I AA player. That season, he had 96 receptions for just under 1,400 yards and 19 touchdowns. In 2014, Brian was inducted into the Villanova Sports Hall of Fame. He was an undrafted free agent signed by the Seattle Seahawks in 1999. played in the NFL from 99 to 2010 with the Eagles and the Falcons. He also played in NFL Europe for the Barcelona Dragons and was named All-NFL Europe. Over the course of his NFL career, he had 238 receptions for just under 3,100 yards, and he scored 19 touchdowns. You can hear him now here in Atlanta on AM 680, The Fan, and also doing color analysis for his alma mater, particularly the Villanova basketball team. And it's been far too long since we've had Brian here on Thursday Night Tailgate, but we're glad that he's back with us again tonight. Hey, Brian, Chris and Bob here. Thanks for coming back on the show.
Yeah, no worries. Happy to do it again. Excited to talk to you guys, talk a little football. Enjoyed the last couple gentlemen that came on, Don and Tony. Some pretty good information from those guys and some old-timers that have been and experienced a lot. So hope a lot of people were listening to what they had to say.
Ah, appreciate that, Brian. So, Brian, before we talk about your playing career, get your thoughts on the Falcons this season, I have to ask you about your alma mater, Villanova. Like I mentioned in the intro, you do color analysis for Villanova basketball for CBS Sports. So you were right there when they won the national championship. What was it like for you when Chris Jenkins made the game-winning three-pointer at the buzzer and all of a sudden your alma mater's national champions?
So it was a fluky deal, Chris, because Turner Sports does True TV and True TV, TBS, and TNT. And they had three broadcasts going for the Final Four weekend, and they had their team stream where they invite alumni, somewhat famous or popular alumni from the schools that are in the Final Four, to call the game for their team streams, which is kind of a homer broadcast. So I was on True TV for Turner Sports, and it was just an off-the-cuff. I think they picked five guys from Villanova. They sent it to the SID up there, and I assume that Kerry Kittle and Tim Thomas and Howie Long all declined because it fell right in my lap, and I gladly accepted and got a nice little trip to Houston to see my alma mater, Villanova Wildcats, win that game and beat the heck out of the Oklahoma Sooners in the semifinals. And when I tell you, it was probably the greatest sports moment, especially as a fan in my life. There is no denying that. It was. When Archie Diacono drops the ball off to Chris Jenkins, it's 15 feet in front of where I'm sitting on the court side. I stand up out of my seat and watch that thing go in the net, and it's just bedlam breaks out. It was really a fascinating, exciting, enthralling experience.
Yeah. So, are you losing your mind, going crazy, jumping up and down? You know, is there a voice in the back of your head saying, "I'm on the air here. I got to try to contain myself."
Yeah. You know what? That's the great thing about being on the team stream, that they encourage you to do stuff like that. So it was not like a real – I'd have to worry about being Jim Nantz or Costas or any of these guys. I could be Brian Finneran, Villanova alum and former football player that wants my team to win. So Scott Graham, myself, and Casey Casey McDonald, all three of us had a little bit of something, connection. Casey and I were alums of Villanova, and Scott Graham had done a bunch of stuff for the basketball program the last few years as well as call games. So – we were free to do whatever we wanted, man, and we just had a blast with it, and that was a treat about it. We didn't have to be too serious. We could have fun and yell and scream, and it was encouraged.
So, if you're having a bad day or struggling a little bit, do you go by the computer and go over to YouTube and watch that video, perk yourself up?
I have once or twice. I'm not gonna lie to you. And every once in a while, the magnet you put on the back of your car. I just got my Villanova 2016 NCAA championship magnet. They sent me in the mail. So every so often something reminds you about it, and you go back and look at it and reminisce.
So, Brian, like I mentioned in your intro, when you were at Villanova, you won the Walter Payton Award back in 97, the AA version of the Heisman. So, so many great players have won that award along with you, Steve McNair, Brian Westbrook, Tony Romo come to mind right away. Talk about what it's like to be recognized as the best player at your level.
Man, it was so special. And I was the first and only receiver for the longest time until I think last year another receiver won the award. But it's the ultimate team award as well. The only reason I was able to catch 19 touchdowns and 96 passes was because the other receivers on my team were great and they had to respect them as well. And then the quarterback I had and Todd and Chris Bowden, who was a sophomore at the time, was phenomenal. I literally remember dropping one pass that whole year. I know I dropped a couple more, but vividly in my mind, I ran a corner route And he threw a perfect ball and just went right through the breadbasket. But other than that, I mean, every ball that kid threw was just the most catchable, easy, smooth, perfect spot. And it was great. My twin brother Brad was on that team as well. And so at 6'5", you know, 200 pounds, two of us out there, another guy, Josh Dalvin, Chris Bowden had his pick of the litter. And then our offensive coordinator was Dave Clawson, who's the head coach at Wake Forest now. Great offensive mind and really made sure that I was the go-to guy in the slot there, and we just made a bunch of things happen. But to win that award was pretty special. Anything that can go around a name like Walter Payton and what he did not only on the for the game on the field but off the field is pretty special. So it was a it was a great moment to sit up there and receive that for myself and Villanova.
Bob, questions for Brian?
Hey, Brian, and just one more thing about Villanova. I mean, I grew up watching guys like Mike Ciani and Howie Long, and then I don't think people realize I think people have the idea that not many people from Villanova made it to the NFL, and that's not true. If you go back, there are a ton. They might not have stayed as long as some other colleges, but, I mean, there are a lot of Villanova alum that have come and gone, especially guys like Brian Westbrook we're more familiar with. But just knowing the history of guys like Ciani and Long, when you were there, Brian, did the success of those guys fuel you to almost continue on your NFL quest?
You know what? Not initially, but as I started becoming a better football player and having some more success at Villanova, I started seeing some of the names that I was creeping up on in the record books. And the guys like Bob Brady and Mike Ciani were at the top of that list. And I just kept picking them off one by one. And I think it was my senior year on a homecoming game. I had like 5 catches, 4 touchdowns, like 100 yards. And Bobby Brady was in the building just in case I broke his records. And on that night I broke his catches, reception record, and his touchdown record in a career at Villanova. And it was great because after the game, he was able to come out, shake my hand, give me the game ball, and be a part of that. So pretty special. And you're exactly right. There's more. Villanova's been playing football for 100 years, and they got a ton of guys that have – there's a ton of history up there. They used to play the big boys in bowl games, and I'm talking about a long, long time ago. They dropped the program in 81 or 82 and brought it back in 85 or 86, and that's when they went to 1AA. So before that, you know, 75 years, 100 years, they were playing 1A football with the big boys and having some success. So Villanova's been around a long time. It's highly thought of as a basketball school, which is fine, but we won a national title in 1AA FCS football in 09, been in the playoffs religiously the last 10 years, and now we got another basketball title to talk of too. So Villanova's going nowhere, and football's going nowhere. Andy Talley's last season is coming up, and Mark Ferrante, the O-line coach and assistant head coach, will take over, and they'll be in good hands up there. But I think Coach Talley has been there since they brought the program back, so over 30 years, and done a fantastic job building Villanova football into a bit of an FCS dynasty.
And, Brian, a two-part question. Your rookie year, people will associate you playing your whole career in Atlanta, but you did spend that 1 year. You got into 3 games with Philly. Speaking of your Philadelphia school, how cool was it just to stay near your college for that rookie year? And tell me, for the little time you played, about how did you like Andy Reid and a guy that's still coaching these days?
Yeah, it was a bumpy road for me early on. I went to – as Chris said earlier, I went to Seattle as an undrafted free agent right out of school in 98. I got cut. I went home, lived with my in-laws, got a job. I worked out with Todd and Marv Marinovich out in Southern California, tried to get stronger and better. Did that. Then that's when I went to Europe and played for 4 months over there in Europe for the Barcelona Dragons. Improved on some of my football skills, how to play special teams, be a better receiver, put about 10 pounds of muscle on. And that's when I landed in Philadelphia right after the Europe season, so I had about 3 weeks off, and then I had to get ready for football for training camp in Philadelphia, where we went to Lehigh University. And Andy Reid's first year, Donovan McNabb was, I think, the number 2 overall pick maybe for the Eagles that year, and we were off and running. Doug Peterson, of all people, who's the head coach of the Eagles now, was our quarterback. They were going to let Donovan McNabb kind of cook it a little bit on the sideline and learn how to play the NFL game. So it was a little rough, though. My first game, I had a bad drop, and you live and you learn. I played a few more games after that, but the fifth week of that season, Andy Reid didn't think I could do anything for him and ended up cutting me from the squad. That's when I spent 8 weeks out, landed with the Falcons after that. But Andy Reid's first year, they struggled. They were trying to find their way, and Doug Peterson was a quarterback, like I said. So McNabb came in like week eight or nine when I was already gone and had some growing pains. But after that, forget about it. What Andy Reid was able to do with Donovan McNabb and that football team for 10-plus years and the number of playoff runs they made, it's unfortunate they couldn't get to more Super Bowls and try to win one. But he's a special football coach. I enjoyed being around him the short time I was there. And, you know, things happen for a reason. I got cut and landed in Atlanta and spent the next 11 years down here and have made it my home, and I can't be more grateful for that. So God has a plan for everything, and it's all worked out fantastic. But Andy Reid was a great coach.
We are talking with former Villanova and Atlanta Falcons wide receiver Brian Finneran here on Thursday Night Tailgate. We've got our next guest, Dwight Hollier, hanging on the line. We're going to get to Dwight in just a few moments. Brian, a couple more before we let you go, though. As we look ahead a couple of weeks to the opening of training camp, you know, right up here in Suwannee for the Falcons, what do you remember about all those years in Falcons camp, and what are your expectations for the Falcons this season?
You know what? I do miss camp a little bit. Somebody asked me the other day, do you miss training camp? And it was like 98 degrees out here and humid and brutal. And I was like, I kind of do. I was like, I kind of miss football. And it's not necessarily the games. It's the locker room. It's being out there sweating and running routes with your quarterbacks and just catching balls. And the guy responded, he's like, no wonder I didn't play football, because I can't stand this weather walking around with shorts and a T-shirt on. God forbid I put a helmet on. So you got to be a little bit crazy and a little different to love the game of football, because it's as tough as it gets, and it can be a grind, and it can be miserable at times. But there's nothing better than playing in the NFL and being a part of that. And the Falcons this year, I'm probably a little higher on the team than a lot of guys, especially locally here in the media on 680 The Fan. Some of my cohorts are banging on them pretty good, whether it's Kyle Shanahan or the tough schedule coming up, and Thomas Dimitroff struggling the last few years trying to find the right players. But I'm excited. I think they had a good draft. I think they did a great job finally, after 3 or 4 years, finding the successor to Todd McClure at the center position, to go and get Alex Mack and break him off with a big deal. Hopefully Mohamed Sanu can come in and be the younger type Roddy White, super athletic type receiver that can get in the end zone 5 or 6 times and come up with 50, 60 catches and do some nice things. And then a young defense that Dan Quinn is excited about, a bunch of young, speedy linebackers, a safety they got out of Florida, and Keanu Neal and Desmond Trufant at the corner position. So they got to find out how to sack the quarterback, and they need to score some more points in the red zone in Kyle Shanahan's offense. But I'm excited about this team. I'm excited about where they're heading. I'm excited about the draft, and I'm thinking it's a little lofty, the schedule and what they did last year, but I'm thinking 9 or 10 win season for our Atlanta Falcons.
Wow. All right. And Brian, before we let you go, remind our listeners about your show here locally in Atlanta, AM 680 The Fan, and how they can follow you online and over social media as well.
Sure. I'm on at bfin86 on Twitter and Instagram, which I don't use enough. I probably should use it more. And then, like you said, 680 The Fan, also on 93.7 FM right here in Atlanta, local sports talk. Our show is called The Front Row. It's myself, Steak Shapiro, a longtime Boston guy, moved down here 20 years ago and been doing sports talk his whole life, I think. And then Sandra Golden, the lovely Sandra Golden, who adds a little bit of class to our radio show. So we have a blast, and we have a good time and just try to have fun with what we do. I will say this. I enjoyed listening to Tony Collins and Don earlier, and I'd reiterate what Tony Collins said about the youth of our world today and respecting authority, because that has gone right out the window. And it's a shame. And it's a reason. It's not the only reason, but it's a reason a lot of things are happening in our world today. So hopefully we can learn a lesson from Tony. If I can just reiterate that, a little more respect for authority, ourselves, you know, God above and each other, which would go a long way if people would just be better. Just be better every day and try to figure out how to be a good person.
There you go. Brian, thank you so much for that. and B, for your time tonight and coming back on the show. We hope you'll come back much sooner next time. We've missed having you on the show. You're one of our favorite guys that we sort of launched this show. You were very early on. You joined us several times, and it was a blessing that we got to have someone like you very early on this show, and we hope you'll come back again real soon.
Absolutely. I enjoyed doing it. So you guys hit me up during the season this year. We'll do it again.
All right. Thanks, Brian. All the best to you and your family.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
That is, again, former Villanova and Atlanta Falcons wide receiver Brian Finneran. And, you know, it's interesting, Bob. So many times, Brian, you know, obviously had a great college career, right? You know, winning the Walter Payton Award, the 1AA version of the Heisman. And he remembers dropping a ball, right? I mean, it's interesting to me. The guys, you know, at this level and at his level, and at all the, you know, the level that the guys were always blessed to talk to, that make it, you know, to the pinnacle of their sport. So many times they remember the one or two mistakes that they made above, you know, all the great things that they were able to accomplish.
Yeah, isn't it amazing? It probably made him a better football player. I mean, trust me, I remember him. You know, being a Fordham grad, we had to deal with Villanova a lot, and not just a basketball school. And Finneran was a tremendous college player and went on to such a respectful NFL career, played for Coach Reeves, and we'll talk about that next time with him, Chris, but always a pleasure talking to Brian.
Yeah, absolutely right. All right, we are going to get to our next guest, Dwight Hollier, on the other side of these words from our friends at the French Lick Resort.
Now's the time to plan that golf getaway you've been dreaming about at French Lick Resort. We have new Golf Academy packages for 2016, guaranteed to take your game to the next level. Try our one-day Quick Fix Academy for golf emergencies. For more in-depth learning, try the Game Changer, designed to make you a better player. Our staff professionals are ready to work with you at French Lick Resort. Did you know there's only one place in the country that you can play courses designed by two members of the World Golf Hall of Fame on the same property? The Pete Dye and Donald Ross courses at French Lick Resort make us an ultimate golf destination for 2016. Check out the Ultimate Golf Package, the Hall of Fame Package, and other great offerings at FrenchLick.com. Let 2016 be that year you finally take your dream golf getaway at French Lick Resort. Play the courses champions play.
This is Reggie Kelly, former Cincinnati Bengals and Atlanta Falcons tight end, and you're listening to TNT, Thursday Night Tailgate. Brace yourself for the explosion.
Now back with us and making his third appearance on the Kyven Foods guest line is Dwight Hollier. Let me remind you about Dwight's background. He is from Hampton, Virginia. Played his college ball at the University of North Carolina, where he was awarded the Patterson Medal for his athletic accomplishments, sportsmanship, and leadership for the 1991-92 school year. He was a fourth-round draft choice by the Miami Dolphins in 1992, and he played linebacker in the NFL from 92 to 2000. All but one of those seasons was with Miami. He played his last season up with the Colts. Over the course of his career, he had 400 tackles, three sacks, two interceptions, and one forced fumble. He was named one of the top 100 Miami Dolphins of all time by SB Nation and the Finsider. He's now the VP of Wellness and Clinical Services for the NFL, and we are very honored that he is back with us again tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Dwight, Chris, and Bob here. Thank you for joining us again.
Good evening, Dwight.
Hello, guys. It's always a good time to be on your show. Thanks a lot for inviting me back.
Thank you.
So, Dwight, let's start things off by talking about your role as the VP of Wellness and Clinical Service for the NFL. Talk about what that role is and some of the things that that you're involved with now and doing to help the players, both physically and emotionally.
Well, we work with a great team of folks in the player engagement department, and we work on a lot of the educational information that go to players, the particularly the rookie curriculum from when they get to the clubs to the end of the season. You know, there's a educational programs and other supports that we try to put in place and support the player engagement director at the club. so that they can execute with those rookies and support those rookies all the way through. You know, part of my role is also work on a lot of the mental health initiatives. You know, part of my background is that mental health piece. So those are some of the main things that I'm responsible for in the player engagement department.
And, you know, as you mentioned a moment ago, Dwight, I know, you know, you've been a counselor, you know, in your career and that sort of thing. You know, talk about, you know, we talk about, you know, the importance of, you know, mental side of the game. And guys, you know, we talk to so many of your peers and the alumni players that are sort of struggling, you know, with, you know, enjoyment of life, if you will, post being in the game, whether that's, you know, as Brian Finneran talked about a moment ago, you know, the thing that they miss most is the camaraderie in the locker room and those sorts of things. So when, you know, when the career is over, it's over. And then that piece is taken away from them. And then, you know, obviously dealing with the joint pain, and we talk to guys that have, you know, problems with sleep apnea and, you know, the concussion issues out there for, you know, it's so prevalent over the last couple of years. But as a counselor, talk about, you know, the mental side and trying to help guys, you know, in life after the game.
Well, I think you hit on it already. It's a little bit of all of those things. I do what I do, and thank goodness and thank God I'm able to do it. I do it because of my own struggles in transition. You know, I thought I laid out a great plan for my transition, and, you know, after playing 9 years and doing okay, I fell flat on my face. And so if that can happen to me, you know, even though I went to work 2 months after officially leaving the game, and, you know, I had a master's degree when I left the game, if I can have all those pieces in place and still fall as hard as I fell, then what happens to the guy who didn't have those things in place? And so I'm, you know, part of the reason I'm doing what I'm doing and, you know, been blessed to be in this position is so that I can be a blessing or a shoulder or a guidepost for those who come after me. And that's where I feel like I'm doing what I'm doing, because that's what I'm supposed to be doing.
We are talking to former Dolphins and University of North Carolina linebacker Dwight Hollier here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Bob, questions for Dwight?
It's great to speak with you again, Dwight. And I want to ask you what I did to Don Nottingham earlier in the show, switching gears a little bit, going back to training camps. And how it was in the early days, Dwight, in Florida, staying hydrated, which is a problem. I always think of Corey Stringer this time of the year. But how was it for you? What worked for you back in the early 90s? And how were the training camps? Give us just a little synopsis and how you kept going.
You know, I look back on it, and I don't know how I kept going. Those were some of the toughest training camps around the league, you know, both Coach Shula's training camps and Jimmy Johnson's training camps. They were tough. They were, you know, full padded, two a day, you know, slobber knocker kind of practices, and of course the heat of South Florida. I get off a plane in South Florida now, and I feel like I'm about to pass out. So I am nowhere near the condition for that kind of stuff now. But you train yourself for that. You know, you make sure you hydrate. You make sure that you spend a lot of time down in South Florida, and that was one of the things that I thought was important. Was to be in that area year round, you know, just because of the training opportunities and getting acclimated to the weather was important. It was definitely a weapon in September. You know, when New England and the Jets and all those teams came down in September, they were getting pretty well beat up because of the weather. That heat was like a 13th player out there for us. And then they got payback when we were in Buffalo and New England in December. But it definitely takes a lot of work on the guys' behalf to get ready for the season. And being there year-round, training in that weather certainly helps.
And, Dwight, those first 4 years under Hall of Fame coach, of course, Shula got a lot of the credit, as he should have. But I always believed that Tom Olivadotti was a very good, underrated coach, maybe just because he was working under Shula, but a guy that you spent a lot of time with those first 4 years. Describe him for us and your relationship with Tom.
I thought Coach Olivadotti was definitely a good coach. It's hard to describe. Sort of like a little quiet, but he knew his stuff and he'd get in your butt if he needed to, but he really was great at working with his other coaches. So he allowed his position coaches to really lead, and so I spent a lot of time getting chewed out by Coach Hill and not so much by Coach Olivadotti. But I think the defense was always a piece of our game that was we always were competitive. We were always tough on defense and as a team overall. And I think he was underrated and did a great job with our defenses there during those times.
Dwight, let's go back to your time at the University of North Carolina. We just had Brian Finneran on, whose alma mater is Villanova, and he got to announce the Villanova, UNC national championship game. So he was sort of the joy of victory, and unfortunately, you're on the opposite side of that as the agony of defeat. How tough was it to watch that shot at the buzzer go in and deal with it? We were that close.
Yeah, so you're gonna bring that up, right? And this was all coincidental that I'm coming on right after Brian Finneran. It's all coincidental.
It worked out that way.
right. No, it was a great game and an amazing last 4 seconds of that game. And congrats to Villanova. They really did play well, and I'm really proud of my Tar Heels too. They did everything they could, and unfortunately, they left a little too much time on the clock.
And like I say, going back to your time when you were playing at North Carolina, Dwight. The first couple of years tough. Your first 2 years were also Mac Brown's first 2 seasons as the head coach at Carolina, a couple of 1-win seasons. As a player, coming into a situation like that, I'm curious, how do you maintain the enthusiasm for playing and showing up every day for practice and going through the workouts? Talk about remaining positive and keeping your work ethic going, even though the team is struggling as hard as it did.
I think that's the mastery of Coach Brown. If he wanted to go into politics right now, he'd be a lock-in for governor somewhere. He just has the kind of charisma and he really loved us. You can feel his genuine care and feelings for us, and when a coach is if he can get you to buy in the way that Coach Brown got you to buy in, then you can get up after those losses and you know, it teaches you to be resilient, to weather the storm, to understand that we were going to get better, that there was a bigger picture here, that we were laying the foundation for something greater. And I believed it, my teammates believed it, and we went out and we fought. And, you know, we weren't getting slaughtered. We were there was a couple of games we got hammered pretty good, but we were in most of the games. So you could see the light at the end of the tunnel. And Coach Brown made us believe, and I think it was part of the mastery of his coaching.
We're talking to former University of North Carolina and Miami Dolphins linebacker Dwight Hollier here on Thursday Night Tailgate. And Dwight, one more before we let you go. Our next guest is John Bock, as you know, a former Dolphins
My
offensive
man.
Lineman. As Bob mentioned, you know, talking about training camp, I got to imagine you had a couple of times to knock heads with John. What was that like?
Yeah, well, John and I had more than enough times to bang heads, and John's a great guy, a heck of a competitor, and I think he would agree that we kept each other on our toes. It was a great competition. You knew you were going to be in for a fight anytime you see him lined up over you, and I think he probably felt the same about me. So John's a great guy, great brother, and a good man.
There you go. Dwight, before we let you go, let our listeners know, how can they follow you online and over social media and keep up with all the great things you're doing?
Well, you can follow me on Twitter at dfin, D-F-I-N-50. And that's really the main social media piece that I have. I haven't gotten into Instagram or any of the other things as of yet, but Twitter is a place where I enjoy connecting with folks and sharing various quotes that I enjoy and updates on things that I see going on.
Well, Dwight, we can't thank you enough for coming back on the show again tonight. Always great for us to get the opportunity and the privilege to talk with you. We hope you'll come back and do it again during the season. Love to get your insights and thoughts on how the Dolphins are doing and what you're seeing from them on the field. But in between now and then, thank you very much, and all the best to you and your family, Dwight.
Thanks, Dwight.
Chris and Bob, it's always a pleasure. And, you know, let me know the next time I can get on. I enjoy speaking with you guys.
We appreciate it very much, Dwight. Take care. We'll catch up with you again real soon.
As long as you don't put me behind, as long as you don't put me behind, you know, Villanova or some other team that we've lost to.
You got it. We won't put you on behind Brian Finneran, and if UNC or the Dolphins happen to lose, we won't put you behind the guy that played for those teams.
We'll switch the order.
That set me up.
Take care, Dwight. Thank you again. We'll catch up soon.
Take care.
Good night.
Okay. Bye bye.
This former North Carolina and Miami Dolphins linebacker, Dwight Hollier. And you know what, Bob, you look at all the great things that, you know, Dwight was a heck of a ball player, and we'll talk with John Bock about it, you know, as well. But, you know, and I love that, you know, what he said about, you know, Mac Brown and, you know, and believing in what you're doing to stay the course and guys hang with me, we're going to get better. And lo and behold, they did. So, you know, some great stuff. And Dwight, what a great guy.
And he's, a scholar on top of it, Chris. Had his master's degree before he left the game, so he was privy to how important education was before he even got to the NFL. But it's always a pleasure speaking with him, and very, very accommodating also.
Indeed. All right, before we get to our next guest, John Bock, I want to give a shout-out to our good friend Renee Shull at Career Engagement Institute. Folks, and if you follow me on Facebook, I wrote a piece about Renee because, you know, she's just such a great person and always so positive and doing so many great things. And if, like I say, go check out what I wrote on my Facebook page. You'll see a little bit more about how much she means to us and so many other people. But, you know, more immediately, if you're upside down in your career, and what we mean by that is, you know, you're ready to move on, go to Career Engagement Institute to see how Renee can help you. You've heard Toy Cook. you know, very recently bragging on Renee and singing her praises. If you work with Renee for 2 minutes, you're going to understand why Toy and why we brag on Renee every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate. You know, we all want to work with someone that we can trust and who actually has our best interest at heart. And you know how hard it is to find someone who fits that description. Well, you're not going to find anyone better than Renee Shaw, because she really does. She is smart. She's creative, very talented, the kind of person you want to work with and have working for you. Renee has been doing some great things from some of our guests who have been in transition to being pro athletes and are now getting into the job market. Folks, I promise you, I'm telling you, she's just the very best. There isn't a better way to describe Renee than that. If you're an athlete or anyone in the job market, do yourself a favor and reach out to Renee. You're going to be so very glad that you did. Go to careerengagement.institute online and give her a follow on Twitter at Integrated Play. All right, now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is our good friend and former Dolphins and Jets offensive lineman, former head coach of the undefeated Brooklyn Bolts back in when they had the FXFL, and Thursday Night Tailgate Hall of Famer, John Bock. John, been far too long, my friend, since we've had you on the show. How have you been?
Hi, John.
I've been fantastic and so happy to be back.
So, John, I'm sure you heard, we just had Dwight Hollier with us on the show. We had Don Nottingham, a former Dolphin, on at the top of the show. But you heard Dwight, I'm sure his comments about what it was like banging heads with you in training camp. Let's turn the tables. What do you remember about going against Dwight?
Well, you know, Dwight may not have said that much because I named him in the lawsuit versus the NFL for head injuries, because Dwight had a head that would knock you out every time he hit you. So I named him as an alternate in the lawsuit versus the NFL.
Wow.
No, Dwight was a fantastic player, smart guy. But if you had to play against him, he just hurt you every time he could. So, you know, Dwight the Head is pretty much what he was always called. And he was a great player for Miami and for North Carolina. And, you know, somebody that I consider a dear friend, and I miss him very much. Wish I saw him more.
And, you know, John, talking about training camp, you know, we're you know, just a couple of weeks now away from, you know, training camps open all across the country, all the, you know, teams reporting. And curious to get, you know, get your thoughts, you know, how different camp was for you when you were in it versus what you're seeing the players go through now.
Well, you know, we all talk about how hard camp was, of course. It was always two-a-days. You know, you went two-a-days for at least 10, 12 days in a row, where now it's only one a days. But, you know, my friend James Brown got sent to Cleveland the first year Cleveland had a team after the teams changed. And they had three a days for 30 straight days without a day off.
Wow.
So it was a lot different just 10, 12, 15 years ago than it is now. You know, now they don't even hit. They have one a days. They're only on the field maybe five times in a week, where we're on the field 15, 17 times in a week. So it's very different than it ever was. And even now, during the regular season, we would hit 3 days a week in the regular season. So three times a week times 17, what, 52? So we had 52 padded practices in a season. Now they're only allowed 14 padded practices in 17 weeks. So the amount that they hit is very, very different.
So let's talk about the pluses and minuses of that, John, because as I mentioned, we had Don Nottingham at the top of the show. And what Don talked about, he was a 17th round draft pick. Obviously, that doesn't exist anymore. But he talked about how, you know, back then he had a lot more opportunities. As you talk about two-a-days and all of those sorts of things and padded practices and being so much different now, he had a greater opportunity to make a name for himself, because, you know, he's a long shot as a 17th round draft pick, as guys are today that are either sixth or seventh or undrafted free agents, have a very rare opportunity to make
the 13th free agent. The 13th college free agent they signed is 17 now.
Right. So as you think about that, you know, they don't have that kind of opportunity or as ample an opportunity to make a name for themselves and make a team like Don did back in the day. So that's sort of a minus for a player, right? The plus is you know, hopefully they're taking more injuries out of the game, you know, less opportunities for concussions and all that other thing. So talk about that. Is it better now for the players long term, or is it not because they don't get the opportunities?
Yeah, I don't believe so, because if you take that criteria, a guy like Wayne Corbett, who led the NFL in receptions, all-time leader for 4 years, his first 4 years, doesn't make a roster. I don't make a roster. Don doesn't make a roster. The thing about an extended training camp is it gives a player a chance to beat out a draft choice, and when you have limited opportunities, I don't see it that way. I think it's stacked the other way.
Bob, questions for John?
And John, we had talked to Dwight, and we talked about the heat of Miami and training in that, and how to become to use it as your advantage, John. I mean, did you ever find that the teams from north coming down there? He said September, October. I'm thinking maybe November. There was hot days in November in Miami where a lot of these teams were probably having a rough time. Did you ever take advantage of that? Did you think you always had an advantage of that?
Yes, we always did, without a doubt. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I played in the Midwest. I played at Louisville. And the hardest thing for that what happens is when you're used to, you know, let's say 65 degrees, 60 degrees in November and October, and you have to play a warm game, it wears you out. It absolutely wears you out. And it goes the other way as well. When I was at FAU, we went and played the quarterback for Dallas. What's his name?
Tony Romo?
Who's the quarterback for Dallas?
Tony Romo?
Tony Romo. So we played Eastern Illinois in Tony Romo's last year. And we took a bunch of kids out of Delray Beach, Florida, and then tried to play them in, you know, late November up in Eastern Illinois. And we got beat like we stole something because our receivers are so cold, they didn't want to catch the ball. So it goes both ways. You know, when you go from warm to cold, there's a disadvantage. And when you go from cold to hot, there's a disadvantage.
Very interesting. And those four of the years that you spent in Miami, John, you played under Jimmy Johnson. Wanted to get your opinion of him as a head coach. What did you as a coach take from him, if anything, as a coach, and some of his strengths?
I think the biggest thing you take from Jimmy Johnson is, to me, this is a very passionate argument, because I don't like coordinators being head coaches. I just don't think that you can be both. It's too hard to be a head coach, more or less be a coordinator and a head coach like we did with Adam Gase here in Miami. And what I always liked about Jimmy was, now Jimmy recruited me in high school, and Howard Snellenberger recruited me in high school. And I went and played for Howard over Jimmy. Then when my time was up in New York, Jimmy already had a plan for me to come to Miami. So, I mean, Jimmy, I listened to Troy Aikman's, the special again, Troy Aikman was the same thing. If Jimmy targeted you, he loved you and he wanted you to succeed no matter what it was. But you don't have to be a great coordinator to be a great head coach. They are two different job responsibilities. You know, your job as a head coach is to manage the personnel and to manage your staff. If you're a head coach who's a coordinator, you're tilted to one side of the ball, which doesn't always fit. And the one thing that I loved about Jimmy was Jimmy let his coaches coach, and if he didn't like you, he'd fire you at the end of the year. He did not get involved in the day-to-day operations of offense or defense. His job was to manage and run the team. And here's the one thing about Jimmy Johnson. You know, everybody considers Jimmy's tenure at Miami a failure, but in actuality, over those 5 years, between the 4 years of Jimmy and the 1 year of Dave Wannstedt, we had the best record in football, and we had the least sack quarterback. We just couldn't beat Denver in the playoffs, we couldn't beat New England in the playoffs, and we couldn't beat Jacksonville in the playoffs. But that's the biggest thing that everybody misses about Jimmy Johnson is, those 4 or 5 years, that team that he built with Jason Taylor and Zach Thomas and Tim Bowens and Daryl Gardner and all the draft choices that he had, we had the best record in football over those 5 years. And he was never a coordinator. He was only a head coach. He did not get involved in day-to-day operations of either side.
Don, I want to, you know, as we look forward a little bit to the Dolphins this season, trying to get your thoughts. As you mentioned, you know, Adam Gase now, first-year head coach, he comes over after being the offensive coordinator with the Bears. You know, your expectations for the Dolphins this season, you know, can Gase, you know, help that offense and help the team get over the hump? Because this has been a sort of an underachieving Dolphins team for several years now.
Well, it's been an underachieving team for a decade, and everyone's getting frustrated. What I would say is, you know, I don't pay that much attention to free agency and drafts and all that. I'm just not a super fan. You know, I'm not someone who's going to follow my team around. But I heard one great thing out of Adam Gase, you know, from the guys who have been spending time around the complex and everything else. And I think Adam Gase said it best. And for a guy as young as he is, I think it was extremely insightful. And what he said was, you know, when you used to draft a guy in the first or second round, he was ready to play in the NFL. And he goes, now when you draft a guy in the first or second round, you're hoping that you can teach him how to play within 3 years before his contract expires. And I think Adam Gase, for a man who's, what, 33, 35 years old, he's a young guy, for him to have that kind of wisdom that he understands that the players that are going to be drafted by the personnel department aren't ready to play, and he's got to prepare for guys outside the personnel department that he already has, that they've already brought in, they've already done all that. I thought it was absolutely a brilliant statement, because I don't think there's one coach that you would talk to that would tell you, with the limited amount of practice time and the limited amount of stuff that kids are doing in college and the various of offenses that they're running, that a guy that you drafted would be ready to start for you day one. And I thought it was a brilliant comment, and I haven't met Adam Gase yet, but that was the one thing that I've heard from guys who have met him, and I thought it was a great statement.
So why is that the case? Why were guys used to be ready to go, come in and start right away, but this, you know, this generation of players, it's going to take you a couple of years? What's the difference?
All right, let me ask you, why do you think? And I'll give you my answer, and I don't know if I'm right or not. But let me flip that question back to you. Why do you think that guys are not ready out of college to play in the NFL?
I don't know. I mean, I guess my guess would be, you know, again,
making $500,000 a year, $500,000 to $1.1 million for coordinators and position coaches. So why are kids not ready to play in the NFL coming out of college?
I don't know. Give me your thoughts.
I'll give you an example. I'll give you Mario Cristobal from Alabama, the assistant coach of the year.
Okay.
Why? None of it makes sense to you?
No.
Because college coaches are based on recruiting. They're not based on teaching. It's a big difference now. That's why the average tenure of a college coach is 3.3 years at a Division I university. It's because they coach and they leave. It's about recruiting. And if you can't recruit, you're done. So what happens is these colleges, you have the coordinators who are smart and they don't recruit. And then every other position coach on the staff is a recruiter. He's not really a position coach. He's a recruiter. So he really doesn't understand the position and doesn't understand what the offense or defense is. He's a guy with a good personality that can recruit. And you look around the league, that's what it is. And you look around college. I mean, that's why very few college coaches can make the jump to the NFL, is because they really don't understand the NFL. It's completely different.
So I want to make sure I understand what you're saying. So they're good recruiters, guys with good personalities. They're not good teachers, so they're not developing these kids. They brought them in. They did their job. Now they're gone a couple of years later. The kid is left having not been coached as well as he used to be, or the player used to be. So therefore, they're not ready once they get to the NFL. Is that what you're saying?
Yep. 10 years shorter. It's a shorter 10-year for college coaches than it's ever been in history. And that's a statistic you can look up. It's a shorter 10-year, and it's about recruiting. It's not about coaching anymore. You don't see one head coach at the same school like you did Paterno in, you know, I mean, you get it on the list. Paterno and the rest of them that stayed, Woody Hayes, that all stayed in one place for a long time. That no longer happens. Now, even look at Urban Meyer at Ohio State. Urban Meyer recruited a bunch of thugs at Florida. They all flunked out of school. He bails, takes a year off, and goes to Ohio State, and he's doing the same thing to Ohio State right now. You know, you look at Harbaugh. Harbaugh lost the entire program at San Francisco with the 49ers, which is typical of a college coach. A college coach can't handle you can't handle a disciplined guy for that long. And I played for Schnellenberger, and Schnellenberger said the same thing. He was the head coach of the Baltimore Colts. He goes, I'm not a pro coach. I'm a college coach. He goes, you know, there's certain ways you can do things. There's certain ways you can push people for so long. But when guys make a certain amount of money, you got to treat them differently. So coaching in college and coaching in the pros are two completely different things. They're two different animals.
Mm-hmm. So let me get your perspective on something else, John. You know, with the Dolphins, obviously they brought in Ndamukong Suh, a guy who's obviously, you're talking about making a lot of money, obviously a guy making a lot of money. He hasn't made a real impact, though, since signing with the Dolphins.
And I said don't sign him last year when they signed him. So right. I have a year history saying I wouldn't have signed him. That
so,
it was too much money for a low-impact player. Nothing to do with Ndamukong.
So if you're the his defensive coordinator, or you're now Scott Gase, the head coach that gets this guy, how do you reach him? How do you transform a guy like that into being either the player you thought you were getting because he had such an impact when he was over with Detroit, and now you want to try to get that same guy here in Miami? How do you do that?
If I was his head coach, this is what I would have done, and no one will ever do this to him. I promise you that. If I was his coach, I would have went up to him and said, you know what? You're a great player. You're a good person. We all love you. But I didn't hire you to be this guy. I hired you to be a creature feature. I hired you to sit there and change the game the way that we play. And I need you to rally people around you. And if you're not willing to do that, you don't fit in my system. I got to trade you. So you want to be the guy that got traded because you wouldn't be in my system and be my leader? Or do you want to be my leader and get another contract in 4 years where I give you $150 million? And that's what I would say to him.
Yeah. Bob, one more for John before we let him go.
Sure, John. And I think the last time we spoke to you, John, and correct me if I'm wrong, it had seemed to us that you kind of soured on the coaching profession, being the teacher that you are, and you just explained a lot of what happens in the politics of coaching. Where are you right now mentally, John, as far as the coaching mentality? It must be tough for you to watch what's going on at some of these programs, both at the college and pro level. Correct me if I'm wrong. I mean, do you still have that attitude where you're kind of an outsider looking in?
Well, you know, I had a great time this week. I went to Dave Remington, the Remington Award for the nation's best center. He was Boomer Esiason's center at Nebraska, two-time Outland Trophy winner. He was Boomer's center in Cincinnati, and then I was Boomer's center in New York. So he has his camp in Omaha every year. So he called me up, and he invited me and my son to go up there and spend time. And it was, Aaron Graham was there. Eric Crouch was there, a former Heisman winner. Brendan Stye was there. Jake Grove, the all-pro tackle and center for Miami, was there. So we were all up there coaching these high school kids. It was the best week of my life, just being able to teach technique and teach attitude and teach how to finish and what coaches are looking for. I'm soured on the profession because, you know, either one, you gotta go to college, and it doesn't matter how good of a coach you are in college. What actually matters is who do you recruit? And that's why kids' skill levels are so down. And my son's best friend, his godfather, is Larry Bird. Larry Bird and I both went to Indiana State. So Larry and I know each other. When Larry comes down to Florida, he stays at my son's friend's house. So I'll go over there and talk to Larry. And Larry said it the best. Larry Bird said it the best. He goes, you know what? He goes, the athletes in today's basketball are better. But the game of basketball was better in the 80s. You know, we knew how to play. And people talk about how the NCAA women's game is better than the pro game in basketball for men. And I think that statement is so true for the NFL. There are better athletes now, but their skill levels are down. And they're not being coached the right way, because they're not being coached by guys who know how to coach. They're being coached by guys who can recruit and bring in the good athletes. That's a big difference. And that's why the tenures are down. You know, you don't see long tenures anymore. You know, you don't see guys who are in one place for 10, 12, 15 years. It's 3.5 years and you're on to somewhere else and you're hoping to move up. And even when I recruited in South Florida, I go to Delray Beach. I turned down Brandon Flowers and I turned down Pierre Garçon because they didn't have grades and they were 12th on my list. So I'm a stupid coach right there, because those are two of the best players in the NFL. I turned them down from FAU. But you sit there and you look at it and you're like, look, this is what I need. This is what I got to go to. And this is where I want to be at the end of the day. And there's not enough coaches that do that anymore. They're recruiters and they have their areas. And if they get fired, they don't care because they go to your competition school and pick up another job. So it's kind of, you know, it's very difficult.
So, John, are we going to see you coaching at some level, whether it's this fall or sometime in the near future?
Nope. I might write a book, but I'm not going to coach again. I will not. I've been offered a couple jobs, and I just won't do it.
So you mentioned you might write a book. What got your attention about writing a book?
Well, I've written two already. I got one that's published. And basically it'd be, you know, I'd like to write a book to teach fathers how to coach youth football and what's important. Because I believe youth football is fine. If you talk about concussions and holding your kids out of practice and doing this and that, there's really no strength till seventh grade. Under seventh grade, they're all fine. So I always said I would hold my kid out of middle school before I ever held him out of playing tackle football at five. Because if you put your kid in high school with no training and you got some kid that's been playing for 8 years, your kid's in a lot of trouble. That kid runs downhill and hits you face to face. He's going to knock you out if you've never played before. So I'd rather give kids skills when they're young. You sit in middle school while the maturity level changes, because some kids mature in sixth grade, some kids mature in eighth grade. You know, that whole sixth, seventh, eighth grade, that's where the problem is. You know, because you got kids who are full-grown men versus kids who, you know, like I always tell my kid, I go, oh, look, we're German and we're Polish. So, you know, you're not going to be mature until you're 14, 15. You're not maturing at 13. You know, and he plays against kids who are fully grown at that age. So, you know, that would be the way that I would go.
Mm-hmm. So, John, before we let you go, for our listeners, remind them, how can they follow you and see the things that you're doing, gain your insights, whether it's online or it's over social media?
I don't think they can anymore. I'm at Facebook, I'm full. So I have all 5,000 fans, but I'm public. So, you know, if you want to pick my name sometime and see what I have to say, that's fine. But, yeah, I have no agenda. I have no media. I don't do any of that anymore. So,
wow. All right.
I'm full and I'm done.
Well, we're glad that you were here with us tonight, John.
I wish I had something to promote. Let's promote something nice. I'll tell you what. Here's what they can do for me. They can sit there and buy somebody's coffee tomorrow before they go to work.
There you go. Random act of kindness.
You want to sit there and follow me or do whatever? I'm free on Facebook. Go ahead. I'm public. I can't accept any more friends. I'm sorry. But if you want to do something nice, pick up somebody's coffee tomorrow, Dunkin' Donuts.
There you go. John, thanks so much for coming back on the show. We always enjoy our time with you. We hope it'll be a little more frequent than it's been this year. We were spoiled having you on once a month last year. We hope we get to start picking that up, particularly once the season gets going.
Well, I'm around, and I love your show. I think you guys do a great job. Dwight Hollier and the work that he's doing right now was fantastic. So, you know, everyone on your show needs to go back and re-listen to Dwight, because Dwight is a fantastic human being who does a lot of great stuff. And he's one of my dear friends and been one of my dear friends for a long time.
Nah, I appreciate you saying that. John, we'll catch up hopefully soon. In the meantime, all the best to you and your family, my friend.
Take care.
Thank you, my friend. Be good.
All right. Take care, John. That is former University of Louisville, Miami Dolphins, and New York Jets, and he had some time with the Buffalo Bills as well, John Bock. And, you know, one of the great things about John is he's going to tell you like it is, at least how he feels like it is. And that's one of the great things we love about John. There's no sugarcoating anything. You want to know what John thinks? He's going to tell you.
Yeah, and you get the feeling, Chris, you know, it might not have gotten on the right side of a lot of people, but, you know, he's a teacher first. And,
right.
He's got he's a very, very morally based teacher. And the way you describe the game, both at every level now, it's who can you get in here? Who can you get in here? And even get that feeling at the small colleges around here. You'll see, you know, these guys are – tight ends / Northeast recruiter. You know, that's what their title is. And you wonder if it's just too much and a lot of teaching goes out the window because they're pulled in different directions. But we understand John's we understand his dilemma right now and his attitude. And, you know, he sticks to his guns, Chris. There'll never be anything fake about John Bock.
No, absolutely not. But, you know, the one thing that you know, I wish were different is, and I said this in the, you know, in his intro at the top of the show, but, there, you know, from all the guys, Bob, that we've had the privilege of talking to, John Bock is one of the brightest offensive minds, you know, of anyone we've talked to. And we've talked to, you know, some pretty great coaches on this show. But, and I feel like, you know, on some level, I feel robbed of the opportunity. I don't know why, you know, John hasn't gotten, you know, this job or that job or which ones he's actually, you know, raised his hand for. We know that he really wanted the opportunity at the school, the D3 school that was near where he was born. And that didn't work out, but we saw the great success that he was with the Brooklyn Bolts. We see what a great, you know, youth coach he is. John's been a winner as a head coach everywhere he's been. You know, I think, you know, I you know, we're biased because John means so much to us, and he's a TNT Hall of Famer because of how great he's been with us on the show. On some level, I feel a little robbed of the opportunity to see John, you know, on whether it's Saturdays or Sundays with a headset, you know, on the sideline. Because I think he's got a lot to offer the game. I think he's a very technically sound coach. He teaches, you know, like you said, Bob, he's a great teacher, and he teaches his players how to be a really good player. You know, his son, by the way, is one heck of a lineman. And, you know, that's because, you know, John Bock's father, and he's teaching him the right way. But on some level, Bob, I feel a little robbed of the opportunity to see John, teaching the game the right way and seeing him as a, whether it's an offensive coordinator or as a head coach at some level, whether it's at the college level, at the D3, you know, 1AA, Division I, or as a great coordinator on Sundays, because I think he would be one of the best that maybe he's ever been.
I totally agree, Chris. When we were talking to him, we've talked to him so many times over the years, and just how much teaching has come up, and he's taught us a lot of the techniques and,
right,
and things that are incredible, and the all the things that go into making a good offensive lineman and just a good squad. And you just get the feeling that, and you remember he was up for a job at a Division III power up there, and you get the feeling that politics came down. All he wants to do is teach, and call him outdated, call him, you know, just sticking to what he believes in. You know, sadly, and this is, seems kind of crazy, that might have been his downfall as far as getting something in the profession, shall we say, higher up, is because John is not an establishment guy. I mean, he just wants the basic, he wants to go back to the bare bones stuff that he knows works. But sadly, these days, again, it's not about coaching, Chris. It's coaching is like teaching. It's a lot of administrative stuff as opposed to teaching, and I feel cheated myself.
Yeah, you know, and you know, just one last point, and we'll move on. But you know, at the end of the day, I think John Bock is a guy that, you know, like I say, at any level, and any level of college ball, you know, so, you know, coaching on Saturdays, coaching on Sundays. John Bock's a guy that you can hand the keys to and go, you know, go coach. And I should never, you know, they should never have to worry about again what's happening in the program, because John's going to take it over. He's going to be a leader. He's going to get stuff done. And, you know, the team, whether, you know, it's an established team that's a winner already, he's going to keep that going, or he's going to turn the program around. Again, he came in the league, the FXFL, with a, you know, and built that thing. You know, I mean, you remember, Bob. I mean, John almost built that, you know, built that league, or helped build that league, you know, on his own, doing so much of, whether it was financially or organizing and things of that nature. But he took that team and they went 4-0. Again, it's a small sample size. It was a short season. It's a developmental league. But he took those guys and he formed those teams and they went 4-0. Oh, by the way, the year after he left, they were not so good. So, you know, that's what you're going to get with the John Bock and you know, Bob, I, as you just mentioned, and I'll speak for you, we feel a little bit cheated by the by the thought that John's not going to coach anymore, because he's one heck of a good coach.
And you
anyway,
can check with Mike Golic Jr. on that too, right?
That's exactly right. You know, please feel free to send something like that to Mike Golic Jr. He'll tell you all about it.
Right.
All right, when Bob and I come back, we're going to be turning on our Thursday Night Tailgate spotlight on the positive. Then we'll wrap up the show, and we're going to do that on the other side of these words from our friends over at Coastal Orthopedics and Kyben Foods.
Are you suffering from chronic pain in your shoulders, hips, knees, or wrists? Tired of living life with an old injury that just won't go away? If you answered yes to either of these questions, we can help. At Coastal Orthopedics and Sports Medicine, Dr. Candelora and his fine staff of medical professionals will get you back on the road to recovery. Their state-of-the-art facility and attention to detail will ensure you will be enjoying life again and feeling invincible in no time. Since 1991, Dr. Candelora and Coastal Orthopedics have been specializing in joint replacement, arthritis, and osteoporosis care, as well as pediatric and adult general orthopedics. Visit us on the web, www.bone-dr.com, or call our Newport Richey office just north of Tampa at 727-848-1417. Proud sponsors of Mike Ditka's The Gridiron Greats Assistance Fund.
This is Reggie Kelly, former Cincinnati Bengals and Atlanta Falcon tight end, and I'm the owner of Kyben Foods. And if you enjoy delicious food, you're going to love my Kyben products, which consist of our honey apple salsa, sweet barbecue sauce, and an array of seasonings. For store locations, online orders, and recipes, check out our website at www.kyben82.com. That's KYVAN82.com. One taste, and you'll appreciate the goodness.
Hey, hey, welcome back. This is Todd Washington, two-time Super Bowl champ, offensive line coach for the Baltimore Ravens, and you are listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with my boys Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari on the Armed Forces Radio Network. Go get them, guys.
And we're back here on Thursday Night Tailgate, and we're turning on our spotlight on the positive. Bob, who do you have for us this week?
You know, Chris, I'm going to change this up a little tonight. I'm going to throw you a little change up using a baseball term here. I have a guy at the college level who I read about today that just blew my mind, and he is a football player. He is the tight end at Yale here. And his name is Sebastian Little, Chris. He's a native of Cheshire, which is right down the road. Of course, Yale's right down the highway also. But I read more about what Sebastian's doing. Now, he's going into his senior year, Chris. This is a guy, of course, scholar athlete, has gone to Croatia studying abroad and everything. But what he does for the community just blew my mind. This guy, he's a nominee for the All-State AFCA Good Works team. That's a big award out this way. But he basically already, Chris, as a college player, he has co-founded something called NFL Yale, which means the next future leaders. That's where a lot of the Yale players will go into these middle schools, especially in the tough New Haven area, and he mentors them. He is also very involved in this program called Earn While You Learn, spending time at different schools, teaching kids skills about how their future will be affected by the decisions they make. And he is huge, and this is very close to my heart. He's very big in organizing these bone marrow donor drives around here, Chris. And I had at one point the Yale hockey a player on my TV show who was the best friend of this girl, Mandy Schwartz. This Mandy Schwartz had developed cancer, and her teammate, Aleka Hughes, came on the show and was talking all about Mandy, how she was pretty much going downhill at the time, but the importance of blood, marrow, and marrow donations, which many people don't know about. And she did pass away, but, I mean, it is huge now, marrow donor drives in Yale. It is a huge thing right now, and it's important. And Sebastian Little is majorly involved in that. And finally, they do a lot, the Yale football team, to support a very young boy who has cerebral palsy here, Chris. His name is Dante Chiappetta. And that's Sebastian when he's playing football. He gets the team to rally around and support Dante with visits and financially. It's amazing what this guy does at the college level. And we talked about very educated guys tonight. This guy gets it done on the field and off. Sebastian Little, Yale University.
Yeah, wow, that is fantastic stuff, Bob. I'm going to turn the spotlight, Bob, on an entire organization. And as hard as this, you know, you think this could be as a Steelers fan, I'm going to put the spotlight on the Dallas Cowboys, Bob, for a wonderful event that they recently hosted. About 100 underprivileged children got to have a sleepover at the Cowboy Stadium as part of an Ashley Furniture Home Store charity event. And, you know, as you can imagine, you know, the eyes of the, you know, these 100 children got really, really big when they ran out onto the field. And when they got out to the field, there were 100 beds set up on the field, and the kids got to run and pick out which one of those beds they wanted. And on each bed, Cowboys, you know, sheets, pillows, comforters, there were teddy bears, an official Wilson football, a Cowboys hat, and a bunch of other Cowboys swag was there. And then the kids, they got to play games out on the field, you know, for the night. They got to play with some of the Cowboys players and their cheerleaders. They ate pizza. They got to watch a movie on the giant video screen that's in the middle of, you know, Texas Air Dallas Stadium, which AT&T Field, I think is how it's branded now. But, you know, you got that huge video board. They got to watch a movie on there, you know, for the night. So these kids got, you know, sort of a night that they're, you know, they're going to remember forever, right? It's going to be a lasting memory for these kids, you know, for as long as they live. And then, you know, and then they got to go home and they got to take all that stuff with them. They got it on a brand new bed. So some underprivileged kids got, you know, what a wonderful night, what a wonderful, you know, set of memories that they're going to take with them from that event. It's sort of an ultimate sleepover party, if you will, Bob. So I wanted to put the spotlight on the Dallas Cowboys and, you know, Ashley Furniture for doing that and making, you know, making a, like I say, a lasting memory and a lasting impression on some wonderful kids. And they get to get some, you know, some nice swag and a great memory and a great night all along with it. So kudos to the Dallas Cowboys and Ashley Furniture for doing that. And Bob, great example from a wonderful kid at Yale, Sebastian Little. Two great stories.
It is, Chris. And, again, it all ties in with what Tony Collins said. You know, you just a lot of these people, they don't have the luxuries of some other people. They need to know that they're feeling wanted, and everybody needs to help each other instead of be divisive. And these two guys we just mentioned, well, the team and Sebastian Little, and the entire organization in Dallas, it shows that you could have all the money in the world, Chris, you still got to do the right thing.
No, that's a, you know, that's an excellent point, Bob. Yeah, we know Jerry Jones isn't hurting for money, and but the idea that, you know what, you're still doing the right thing for people, right? You know, this is, you know, sort of a, you know, it's obviously our theme every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate, but you point out, you know, the great things that Tony talked about, and Brian Finneran as well made a comment, you know, before, you know, he got off the air. And we know that Dwight Hollier is doing some great things, you know, for some of the players. But that's the thing, right? We got to help each other out, right? It's all, you know, we get hammered all day long with the bad news and the bad things that are happening in the world. And, you know, sometimes it gets to feel overwhelming, even for us. And, you know, Bob, you mentioned, you know, it's sometimes you got to dig for these positive stories because the media wants to hammer us with all the bad stuff. And I don't know what, you know, I don't even get into that mindset. I can't understand it. Right? Why try to drive fear and scare people and all those sorts of things into, you know, manipulating people to doing this thing or that thing or voting you the way you want them to vote and all that kind of stuff, right? Whatever, right? It's all about, you know, doing the right thing, whether you got a ton of money or you got a little bit of money, right? John Bock just talked about, go buy somebody coffee at Dunkin' Donuts tomorrow morning. Do a random act of kindness for somebody, right? It's all about doing the right thing, making everybody else's life better, and trying to promote the things that they are doing and help them up and help them along and all of that sort of thing. If we're all helping one another, right, you know, that is the thing that is going to make, you know, this world a better place. We need to focus on those things. We need to promote those things. We need to hear more about those things on the news and on CNN and on, you know, and on Google and, you know, whatever site you go to online. If we're promoting those things and we're promoting it over social media, we're showing the good things that are going on. Eventually, we're going to choke out the bad because we're all, you know, making each other's lives better, and we're enriching each other, and we're enriching the world by the fact that we're doing good things for one another. Hopefully, Bob, you know, we can continue to do, you know, obviously we're going to continue doing the spotlight on the positive. We're going to continue showing people that, you know, there are other people doing great things in the world, and hopefully that is the way that we do, like we were talking about with Tony, we do less hating and we do more loving.
Very true, Chris. Instead, you know, we're dealing with too many people that are trying to devise divisive tactics, and that's not how things get done. We just have to get to the point where there's enough good publicized where it drowns out all this other stuff. At least that's our hope, and you know, we're going to try hard to do the best that we can. I know that's one of our pet peeves is to see all this stuff. I even had this Sebastian Little piece, Chris, was kind of a small snippet in the newspaper. I had to go online and find out a lot more about him. But when stuff like that starts getting bigger play and drowns out the front page nonsense that we see every day, then this world automatically becomes a better place.
That's exactly right. Hi, my friend. It is time for us to put a bow on this episode of Thursday Night Tailgate. We want to send out our thanks once again to Don Nottingham, Tony Collins, Brian Finneran, Dwight Hollier, and John Bock for joining us tonight. And Bob, like I say every single week, it's the best part of my Thursday nights and best part of the show is getting to spend these 2 to 2+ hours with you, my friend.
Same here, Chris. I appreciate the kindness, and to have talked to so many intelligent and guys that really can have an impact like we did tonight, I have to thank you for that.
All right, so next week, who do we have scheduled to join us? Well, I'm very excited about our lineup for next week. Not that I'm not excited about our lineup every single week, because we are so blessed to have so many great people and, you know, great guests on the show. But next week, looking forward to, we're going to have actor turned ESPN radio host Matthew Lawrence with us. Those of you who are fans of the 80s sort of cult movie, if you will, that was on really went big on HBO, Eddie and the Cruisers. You'll remember Matthew Lawrence. He played the bass player, Sal Amato. And he's been in other TV shows as well. And now he's doing some ESPN radio. So we have the honor of having Matthew Lawrence with us. Can't wait for that. Bob, you turned the tables a little over onto the baseball side. And we're gonna do a little bit of that next week. We're going to have former Dodgers general manager Fred Clair with us. Very excited to get the opportunity to speak to Fred Clair next week. Former Eagles linebacker and another radio announcer has been on our show several times. Kevin Riley is going to be back with us. Looking forward to catching up with Kevin. Then great. Former University of Georgia and Canadian Football League star wide receiver Terrence Edwards, also going to be making a return visit with us on TNT. And, of course, former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins, who, like I say, is with us every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate. So going to be a really great show next week. Can't wait to get there. We wish we could push a fast-forward button to get to next Thursday. But going to be a great show. We hope you'll come back and be a part of it with us. Want to remind you, how can you find us on social media? Well, you can visit our Facebook page. We're there, Thursday Night Tailgate. Please comment and give us a thought, a comment, a like for our Facebook page. We'd appreciate that very much. You can find both Bob and I have Facebook pages as well. You can interact with us there. On Twitter, you can find me. I am at @CTMascaro. Bob is at @Bob_Lazzari. And the show is at TNT Podcast. And you can stream or download any of our archive episodes by checking out our website, ThursdayNightTailgate.com. You can also find us on great podcasting sites. You can replay any of our shows at other places as well. We're on iHeartRadio, TuneIn, Blog Talk Radio, Podbeam, Spreaker, Stitcher, Player.fm, SoundCloud. We are all over the net. You can find us in lots of different places. So we hope you'll take us with you everywhere you go. You can a lot of those sites have mobile sites. You can listen to the show on your mobile device, whatever it is, your smartphone, and check us out. We're lots of different places. We appreciate it very much. We know you've got a lot of shows and a lot of podcasts as you have the opportunity to listen to. We thank you very much for making Thursday Night Tailgate one of them. Bob, take us home, my friend.
Okay, Chris, look forward to next week. And, of course, thanks always go out to our announcer, Joe Lajanusa, for the great job he does with our weekly intro and ads. And to James Brocato and all the guys from Painted Faces for our upcoming outro music. On behalf of myself and Chris, we thank everyone tonight for listening. We appreciate you the most. Until next week, good night, Kevin. We miss you.